Brusho is a transparent watercolor paint that's available in more than 30 colors. Today I'm going to explore the basics of working with it, plus I'll show you how you can convert the crystals into colorful sprays. Brusho is watercolor paint that has been dried and made into a crystalline form. So unlike the typical watercolors that you see that might be a dried cake that's in a pan of colors, or a liquid watercolor that's in a tube, this is in an entirely different form, its little crystals. Now that crystalline form is going to give you the opportunity to do some things that you certainly cannot when you're working with either the cakes or the tube watercolors. I find them to be very highly pigmented. A little bit of the product goes a very long way. Now the one thing that I will tell you is that the product that you see that shakes out, or if you open one of the lids of one of these jars, which I'm going to do for you in a minute, the color you see may not necessarily be the color that the water turns when you add liquid to the crystals. So you just want to bear that in mind. And all of the little jars are labeled, and if you want to put some color swatches on the top and, you know, poke your hole through, you can certainly do that. I haven't, but it's an option so that visually you can see what the color is without actually having to be able to read the label. Now, these are not permanent on any surface. They cannot be made permanent in any way, shape, or form, and so that's something you need to bear in mind. But obviously anything that's water reactive means that we have the opportunity to do some things with it. Now, they're all packed in these 15-gram jars. They do make them available in other sizes, but there's so much product in here, and it's so pigmented, and it goes a very long way. Unless you drop one of these or you use an enormous amount on a project, these little cups, these cans, are going to last you a very long time. So you can see that there is this pull tab here. If you need to access the pigment that's in the whole jar, that's going to be the way to get to it. Initially, if you want, you can simply go ahead and poke a hole in the top, and I'll just have an awl here. I'll show you that in a second. But you'll find, at least I have found, that there are going to be some ways that I want to use Brusho, and to do that, I need to be able to open the top. So you just grab this end of the pull tab. Now the cap is going to want to twist, but you just go ahead and start pulling, and then you remove the entire length of the plastic, and once you've done that, you can go ahead and take the top off. Now I just want to make certain that this is settled, because there's a fair amount of product in here. This is a 15-gram jar. This is going to go, as I said, a very, very long way. So the other option is, if you want to sprinkle Brusho, use something like an awl. Go ahead and poke a hole in the top. And now what you've just done is turned this into a little shaker bottle that you can use to apply just a smattering of crystals. And we're going to look at lots of different ways to work with Brusho starting next. The fact that Brusho is available in this crystalline form means that you can use it in ways that you couldn't ordinary watercolors, either in a cake or in a tube. And so we're going to look at that first. It's probably the demo that you've seen most often with Brusho, which is to sprinkle the powder into water, or sprinkle the powder and then spritz water over the top to get those lovely burst effects. So I have turquoise, purple, and violet, and I'm going to start by just sprinkling a little bit of each color onto this piece of 140-pound watercolor paper. Now the one thing that I have noticed as I've played with this is that the crystals do not always immediately absorb enough water to completely dissolve, and so sometimes you will feel that crystalline effect. You will feel those little particles on the surface of the paper. The way to get rid of that is either to flick them off once it's dry or to add some more water, but obviously if you add more water you will change whatever patterning you already have. So with those three colors on here, I'm going to come in and spritz, and you can see that you get this really great burst effect. Very different, not an effect that you can easily do any other way. Now what you'll also notice is that as I continue to add water, you'll see that there's much more movement and much more traveling as the color and the water move across the watercolor paper. So that's very basic, very straightforward. That's the product down first and then the water down afterward. So let me just mop this up for 1 second, and I'll bring in another piece of watercolor paper, and we'll look at doing just the opposite, which is to put some water down first. Now, rather than just randomly put water on here, what I'm going to do instead, I have a tub of very warm water over to the side. They tell you, Colourcraft, the UK company that manufactures Brusho, tells you that warm water is the best way to activate the crystals. Now, when you have a spritz bottle, it's kind of hard to keep that water warm, but if you have, you know, a tub of water off to the side like I do, it's pretty easy to make that be warm. And so I went ahead and put some quite warm water in here. Now again, the table is cold, the paper is cold, but I'm starting with warm water and hopefully it will be warmer by the time I add crystals than the regular old water that would have come out of the spritzer bottle stone cold. So all I'm doing is using a big number 12 round brush. I could use my mop brush for this if I wanted to, and I'm spreading some water out here. Now you did see a couple of colors pop up because one of those little crystals got someplace, but it pretty much all blended in because it's just one little tiny crystal. So now I'm going to take those same colors, and you can see as they hit the water, they immediately start to bloom. So you have quite a different effect if you work this way than if you go ahead and put the color down and then spritz over it. And you can see that as I've added, this is violet, as I've added the violet, it's kind of pushed the turquoise color out of the way. So let me come in with some purple now, which is a redder color. And you can see immediately that we've got some movement and some pushing, but the difference between these two methods and the results that you get are very, very different. One of the more interesting things that I have found so far is that when you have a wet surface and you sprinkle brusho on the top, at least with this 140-pound and the 90-pound watercolor paper I've been using, you can get this really interesting speckled mottled effect. Now, I did say earlier that brusho cannot be made permanent, but what I have found is that once you get water on top of the crystals, if they have a moment to sit, they're going to leave this kind of odd patterning behind, and that really is just a factor of how the crystals land on the wet surface. So let me bring in another piece of watercolor paper, and I'm just going to wet the surface. Now again, I'm using warm water. I have a tub of warm water over to the side. I'm just going to use my big 1-inch oval mop brush, and I'm going to lay some water down on this piece. You can see that there's a fair amount of color going there. So now what I'm going to do, I have crimson, orange, and lemon. So let's start with a little bit of lemon, and I'll put some out there. Grab a little bit of orange. I'm going to do the same thing. And then I'm going to sprinkle on a little bit of crimson. What you're going to notice is I'm going to come back and take a damp brush again with this warm water. And now I'm going to start to work this around and get these colors to blend. But you'll see that I'm left with some speckles and some mottling. So you need to bear that in mind when you are adding color. Now, I suppose if I really scrubbed at this paper, I could move that color around. But I think it's an interesting effect. It's one that you just need to think about when you're working. Now the other option, and again, let's slide this out of the way, and I'll bring in another piece of watercolor paper. The other option is to go ahead and use a palette or something like your nonstick craft sheet surface, put some color down, use the brush and mix the color on the surface, and then apply it. So my 1-inch mop brush is going to be too big. This is a number 12 round brush. I'm going to go ahead and use this. And once again, I'm not going to put water on here. I could, but because I'm going to mix off to the side, it's really not necessary. So I'm going to put a little bit of the lemon out. I'm going to put a little bit of the crimson out, though there's not a huge difference between that and the orange, but I'll stick a little bit of orange here. And now I'm going to take my wet brush, and you can see that this is pretty wet, and I'm going to mix the color right on the surface. So if I want to start moving color around, now I'm not using a lot here, but you get the effect. If I want to start moving color around and I don't want that splotchiness, those mottled areas to remain, then this is the way to do it. As long as I get those crystals all mixed before I put the color on the paper, well, there's a little splotch of green or something in there. As long as I have that color all mixed before I get it on the paper, then what's going to happen is that the crystals will have already activated and I just get a nice smooth mix and blend of color, again, depending on what I'm doing. So as you see, there's lots of different ways to get color on here. Now something else that's very interesting, and again, let's just go ahead and clean this up, is that you can ghost. So I have a couple of different pieces here. This is the first one I did a few moments ago. I'm going to just spritz water through this stencil, and then I'm going to kind of shove it to one side and let the reactivation occur. Now I've done this with dribbles of water, and I have not tried it this way, so we'll see how it goes. I'm going to just clean this up, and now I'm going to bring in, this is just a solid color, and I want to show you, again, just a plain old water bottle. I'm going to get some nice big drips going on there. And let's bring this back in, and I can see the patterning on here of that's our flower patch stencil. I can see the patterning on there. I'm hoping we're going to see, I don't have a ton of color on here, so I'm not certain how much lifting we're going to get, but we'll give it a whirl and see how it goes. I think it's probably just going to be reasonably light. Oh, actually, it did better than I thought. Look at how cool that is. So now we know that not only can you do this kind of business where you use just droplets of water to create some patterning, and how cool is that, you can also go ahead and you can ghost through a stencil. When you buy a product, you want it to be versatile, and so I spent some time thinking about other ways that I could use the Brusho crystals, and what occurred to me is that I can mix them with water and make my own sprays, and I think that that's a fabulous idea because now I have an entire range of colors available to me. As with most paints, Brusho is completely intermixable, so if you want to let the mad scientist part of you out and you want to start mixing your own colors, then this is a perfect way to do it. You have the crystals available. You can use something like I'm going to do here, which is with a mini mister if you don't want to mix up tons of product. But if you develop a color that you really like, be certain that you make notes about how much of each you added so that you can go back and replicate it. There's nothing worse than having a color you absolutely love and then having no memory of how you created it. So I've already made one with purple. I'm going to come in and grab violet and I'll show you another. Now, as I mentioned way back in the beginning, in order to be able to access the contents of the jar, you have to go ahead and pull this tab to release the lid. So all I'm going to do is pop this open. Now I have a mini mister that I've put a little bit of warm water in, so I'm just going to go ahead and take the pickup tube and the spray head out. I'm just going to use a palette knife. I'm going to scoop up a little tiny bit of the crystals. Now, this is only about half full. And obviously, as I said earlier, the Brusho has a fairly high pigment load, so this is more than enough, and in fact, it might be too much, but we'll see. This is more than enough to get me some really good color. So I'm just, whoops, that's leaking over my thumb. I'm just going to go ahead and shake this, and that looks like a nice deep color, so I don't think I want to add any more, nor do I think I need to dilute it, so I'm going to put the cover back on the Brusho, push it to one side, and mop up what I spilled. And then I'll put the spray head and pickup tube back inside and bring in a little piece of watercolor paper. And you'll see, whoops, where are we here? There's the spray head. Once I get this up and moving, you'll see I get this great color purple. So that actually is violet, and then this color right here is the one that's named purple. You can see that they're pretty close. One is a little bit redder than the other. I can do this with as many or as few colors, obviously, as I want, and I can intermix to my heart's content. These are Brusho basics. I'm certain at some point I'll come back and create another video that shows you perhaps a little bit more advanced techniques, some various other ways to use them, but this is certainly a great beginning.